So I really wanted to do a top 10 list for 2019 movies, obviously. What else do I talk about? And I really struggled just to like find the will to do it. I hate like making lists. My brain does it anyway, but I don't want to rank movies. Very much of the Mikey Newman mindset. Movies, we don't need to rank them. They're here for joy. They're here for entertainment. But there are still a lot of movies from last year that I really want to talk about because there's so many good movies. So, luckily for me, Christopher McQuarrie, maybe you know him, he's a filmmaker, he did this like a little Twitter thread, his 10 favorite movies of the year, and it was not actually movies, but just what specific movies made him feel. I'm gonna crib that. I'm gonna take it. It's mine now. It's mine. So the first one, the one that spoke truthfully to you about your deepest fears and frustrations and made you feel like you were not alone. Starting off on a hard one right up front. It's The Farewell. Maybe this one just hit too close to home. I lost my own grandmother to cancer a few years back. We were very close, but physically we lived very far from each other. So I didn't get to see her that much like the main character that's been Billy. And so when she got her cancer diagnosis, I only got to see her so many times before she passed. And this film very much taps into emotions like that. It magnifies the frustration through certain cultural differences. The family, they're Chinese, and they don't have a practice of really telling their family members that they're about to pass. They keep it hidden from them. They choose to bear that burden instead, which is very effective in making this movie hit a lot harder than it would have otherwise. The acting is so good. There were moments that were physically painful to watch because they were pouring so much emotion into it. And it was that last moment between Billy and her grandmother, who they call Nai Nai. Nai Nai is perfect, by the way, her actress. Best in the movie. She really feels like a grandmother in all the right ways. And there was a moment between Billy and Nai Nai, the last moment between them before Billy goes back to America. So Nai Nai tells Billy the exact same thing I told my grandmother when I last saw her. Like, I had never cried so much that, like, snot poured out of my nose. Like, that very cartoony way to cry until I saw this movie, and that moment... Ooh, boy, that moment was the one that did me in. It dug up some feelings that I didn't even realize I had still buried, and months after seeing this movie, it's still kind of hard for me to talk about it. It's just... it is just that good. Wow, we got emotional really fast. Let's move on to some lighter fare. I hope. The one that offered you escape from the intensity of our everyday reality without completely ignoring that reality. Parasite. I mean, we live in a world of constant class struggles, whether we like to acknowledge it or not, and I think this year I was most aware of it. Maybe just because so many people were complaining about it on Twitter, but still. So it was very much on my mind, and then Bong Joon-ho's absolute masterpiece came out, and I saw a reflection of society in a way that was very real, but also at the same time very exaggerated. Joon-ho is a filmmaker who's always talking about this, whether it's in Okja or Snowpiercer or even his earlier works that not even from this decade. Like, he's been hammering this nail for a long time, and I think he finally hit it on the head with this one. My goodness, does Parasite ever stand out? I'm kind of dancing around talking about the film itself, and that is mostly because I don't want to spoil it. I went in completely blind. I knew the title, I knew Jun Ho was directing, I saw the poster, and all that I had before I dove in, and it was an experience. The one about someone with whom you would never otherwise empathize, that let you see the world through their eyes and truly understand their point of view. Well, I mean, it's Uncut Gems. I don't think there was anything else this year that even really came close to giving me the feelings this movie gave me. And a large part of that was making me not necessarily empathize with, but fully understand the point of view of Howard Ratner, a character who does some pretty questionable things. This is a person who's drowning in their gambling addiction. And he's not a good person at all. Like, in the real world, I would never sympathize with a character like this, but this movie really does drag you into his world, and it never lets you leave until the credits start rolling. And I think Adam Sandler, I mean, performance of a lifetime, really. Not even Punch Drunk Love really compares in my eyes. Like, this is on another level for him. Alright. The one that made you laugh, cry, or scream like you haven't done in years. Finally, something that's not relentlessly hard to talk about. John Wick Chapter 3. I think this one definitely takes it. Not for laugh or cry, but scream? Oh yeah. There were sequences in this film that I was just outright cheering. The stunt work in the John Wick films has been consistently great since moment one, and it's only really gotten better. If I were to like say which one's my favorite, it's probably the first one just because the story is the strongest there, but Chapter 3 has some of the best action, not just in this franchise, but just of the decade. I think Mad Max Fury Road probably compares, but John Wick Chapter 3, I mean, I was squealing at certain points. This one, and I'm not even somebody who likes action necessarily, but this one, I mean, it was white knuckle there for several stretches of filmmaking. The knife museum, the dogs, the motorcycles, the horses, the book. There's a freaking book kill in this movie, and it's glorious. The one that challenged you to accept that part of being human means being deeply flawed and complicated. For me, this is a great reason to do a list like this, because I wouldn't be talking about this film in a traditional top 10 list. Not that I didn't like it, but it wouldn't have really given me much to say without something like this. So, A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood. So there were a lot of good things about this movie, but most of it ended up being just fine, except for the scenes where it's just like Mr. Rogers, played by Tom Hanks, talking to you and letting you know, like, it's okay to be mad sometimes, guys. I don't know why, but scenes like that, they really had an impact on me. So yeah, I think it's gotta be this one. The one that immersed you in some part of history in a way you've never been immersed before. So Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. It's not my favorite Tarantino by a long shot, honestly, but I still really enjoyed it. And a big part of that was I felt like I was in the golden age of Hollywood. Very atypical style for him, where he just kind of lets you hang out in this world without really a plot-driven revenge story or something like that. It really, you just get to drive around with Leo and Brad Pitt and just kind of like absorb the sights, absorb this alternate history, and it really works in a way that I don't think anyone other than Tarantino could have made work. And yeah, I really enjoyed being a part of Hollywood. The one that defined cinema for you. however you define it. So one of the big things for me about cinema is doing something that you can't do in any other medium. Like, you can tell a story with a play, with a book, with a song. So storytelling in general isn't necessarily cinema to me. But what is cinema is using the unique features of this medium to do something kind of new. And that's what Hustlers did for me, at least. There was a scene where one character is wearing a wire to bust her fellow co-workers for their scamming. And they mix the audio as though it's all coming from her wire, so it's a little bit grainy. Her audio comes in very clearly, but other characters' audio is a little tinny, a little distant. You hear things like the rustling of her clothes, her hair brushing over the microphone. And that's something that you can't do really anywhere other than cinema, because, I mean, you can't do that with a book. You can't do that on a stage with a group of actors. You can't do that with a song. You can try, but it won't work well. Cinema is really the only place where something like that could happen. And I mean, the rest of the movie was just great. I mean, Lauren Scafaria has deserved success for a while now, and she's finally got it, so that's another reason why I'm really happy that this one did well. The one we all overlooked or simply weren't ready to understand. It hurts my soul that this movie flopped. It didn't even flop. It was a straight bomb. Missing Link was pure delight for me. Like, I went into this movie expecting, like, oh, you know, it'll probably be like a 7 out of 10. Leica usually does good work. I should be supporting them, so I went to see it in theaters. Trailers didn't really give me much, but I was like, yeah. And I walked out of the cinema like, this is my favorite movie of the year. And to this day, it's still my favorite movie of the year. The main reason for that, it just kind of reached into my brain and pulled out images I didn't even know I wanted and showed them to me. I'm still stuck on certain shots or transitions in a way that no other film this year has made me think about. A lot of people slept on this movie. It is insane how poorly it did. I really hope it finds like new life one day as like a cult hit, the way like Megamind has. The one they just don't make anymore and might never make again. I don't know what else I could put here. It's gotta be Knives Out. You just don't see a classic whodunit story told so well these days. I think Murder on the Orient Express tried, but nobody talks about Murder on the Orient Express ever. We're gonna be talking about this movie for years to come though. Rian Johnson has been doing great work for years now, and all of a sudden he just came out with this masterpiece. How often do you get to see a movie like this in theaters? And I worry we're never gonna see one like it again, because Hollywood is a suspect. And the fact that anybody can make a movie this good, this unique, this fun. This movie is so much fun. Not in the way that like, oh, every few minutes there's a quip that makes the audience chuckle. This is real fun. Like, the opening interviews, the last shot of the movie, and everything in between. Like, I had just the biggest, stupidest grin on my face while watching this one. And yeah, I kind of worry that we're never going to get something like this again. Not just because Hollywood is, like, allergic to making original movies. But just because... who's got the cojones to try and do something like this again? The one that gave you hope for the future. Hey, you... show me that solvable problem. So Steven Universe the movie. I mean, I knew I was gonna like it. I've been a fan of the show since it premiered back in 2013. But I didn't expect it to be like one of my favorite things that Rebecca Sugar has ever done, just in general. It's not gonna work for you if you haven't seen 5 seasons worth of story leading up to it, but for someone like me who's been immersed in this world and who loves these characters dearly, this story in specific, it was really great at just capturing who they are, where they've been, how far they've come. The reason this movie gave me so much hope for the future, not just of its own franchise, but for storytelling in general. This year saw the wrap-up of a lot of big, long ongoing stories that I just despised. I hated the way Game of Thrones ended. I hated The Rise of Skywalker so much. And I really, somehow I hated Avengers Endgame even more than both of those other ones combined. So the fact that any ongoing story was able to kind of wrap up in a way that felt good gives me hope. I was ready to just kind of give up on longer stories in general. I was gonna commit myself to only watching solo films from here on out. Like, I don't want any more sequels. I don't want to get invested in characters without knowing if the people behind them can end their stories well. But the fact that Steven Universe the movie, even though it's not an ending, it was planned to be an ending, and it worked so well for me, that gives me hope that there are still people out there who know how to tell stories. And I really want to see what they do for this next decade. That concludes my top 10 list, Christopher McQuarrie style, for 2019. Please, like, answer these categories yourself and let me know what they are in the comments, because I'm really interested in seeing what kind of films I should have been talking about but weren't able to. And, I don't know how to end a video.
Oh, but I believe in destiny or whatever it is that brought a friend like you to me.